I won't hesitate. You know there's no need to worry. I'm your best bet. And if you say you love me, girl, you ain't seen love. If you say you love me, girl, you ain't seen nothing yet.
So, Saligisiwani Ihina. So, what you might not know is this actually was occupied by the Saligi, or the Aniyawiya, as they called themselves, before the frontiers folks started coming here. So, what we've been doing here on the homestead, we approached it as a frontiers person coming in here as the first settler. We're here on the Nolichucky River. And so John Sevier, whom I think you all might know, right, I think he came to the Nolichucky settlement during that time, built Fort Lee, which was attacked and burned by the Saligi, or the Aniyawiya. So another person who you might have heard of, John Crockett, he also settled here and gave birth, not him personally, but his other half, a significant other named Sarah Hawk, gave birth to somebody who we know and love as David Crockett. And so we have worked really hard to build an 18th century frontier settlement. So we're just going to talk about some of the elements that we put here, and we're going to tell you how we approach this whole project. So you ready?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, my name is Jackie Fisher. I'm actually park manager here. Sometimes I look like this, and sometimes I wear a uniform that's got a badge, but these are both my uniforms. And I'm so delighted. I welcome you all here. If you have questions, you can feel free to ask any of us, and welcome.
Thank you.
Okay, so first we're going to go chicken hunting. Up here, they're all hiding. They're all getting the bugs and worms in the morning. What we've done here is we have all heirloom breeds. And so I was going to show off all of our beautiful chickens, but they're hiding, so we might catch them on the way.
They're over there.
They're on a chicken herd. Hey, men of the frontier, I need some chicken herders.
Oh, got one.
We'll start with this one anyway. And so when people came here from Europe, they all packed in boats and they came here. The animals they brought were really small breeds. And so this one, there are a lot of breeds you won't see today so much. This is called a Polish. These are all bantams, which means they're small body chickens.
Banty.
This is a baby still.
How big will it get?
This will be, have you seen a bantam hen before? I'll show you a
photo.
Yeah. I'm going to put
some over
here. We need another pig feeder.
Pig feeder.
Yeah, there's a home.
Well, he picked some. I've heard pig feeders.
Please look through here, Bob.
pictures of Piggy?
No.
Right here. Right here.
I'm thinking they probably taste a little more gamey.
Yeah.
But this would certainly be a delicacy to have these animals out here. When people settled, they would actually herd the animals. They would bring chickens in baskets and pack them on horses. They would herd cattle and herd swine. And when Fort Lee was burnt down, actually there's a record that says John Sevier actually sent everybody ahead herding the cattle to get to Watauga. But they're great. And so our cabin here represents a first frontier settlement's cabin. So it's made very primitive. The notches are saddle notches, so they seat really easy. The logs are round, they're not hewed, and it's very primitive. It has a dirt floor. It's chinked with mud and straw and cow manure. And so that's how we did our chicken here. We did it all. We had volunteers that built this cabin, and we used all 18th century tools and wore 18th century attire. So we're really proud of it. After you get your first house up, you get your gardens in, you get your animals going, and eventually you build yourselves a more proper home. So eventually the Crocketts were very, very poor people. We don't know really what sort of situation they lived in, but we do know from Crockett's autobiography that they had a house, and they had a fur house. So what would happen is the first house you would build would be repurposed into something else. So it could be animal stables, could be a barn, could be a living quarter for somebody else. And so this really represents the first type of home that the Crocketts would have lived in. And you all are more than welcome to look inside if you want.
House, all of it, every bit of it. What would you think living in a house like that, Sienna? Yeah, a long, 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 long time ago when Davy Crockett lived here, that's what his house looked like.
Hey, Eddie.
And they had to build it themselves.
Excuse me, honey.
Look at the smoke.
Did you
want to
come in? You can come in and look. Can you imagine living here? Look at that bed. Does that look like your bed at home? I bet it does. And look, here's where they put their candles so that they could have a light. They have no light switches.
But they sleep right there.
Yeah, they would sleep right there, wouldn't they? Do you ever get corn that has the green husk on it? Corn on the cob? Well, this is when it's all dried out and they made it into little toys for the kids.
Gee, they didn't even have TV or a microwave.
Look how they
get
slivers on their butts.
Now, where's the...
And your mom would have to cook dinner on the farm. I bet it would taste good.
Morning.
Morning. What you see here are representatives of the animal life that live along the river system here in this area and in the local forests. When the Crocketts came here, as with... many of the settlers, it was a day-to-day survival existence, growing your vegetable patch, your corn, and to get your meat, you would have to go out and hunt and trap your meat. And this is basically for your survival, bringing food into the family, making clothing with each of these pelts, and they also served as currency.
So how come they can still see? Because my grandma has two horses. And my grandma went for a lot of horses.
So I want to say one more thing, and then I'm going to segue into Mr. Steve's conversation with us. And so when folks came on the frontier, there were a lot of men initially. There weren't a lot of women. And there was a Cherokee law that said that if you were a white trader or you were anyone like a military person, that if you came and you moved into Cherokee territory and you settled there, by Cherokee law you had to get married. And so a lot of folks say, I have Cherokee blood in me, my great 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 grandpa, and that really explains a lot of it, because there were a lot of people that did come in and marry Cherokee. The law was that if you married Cherokee, you were Cherokee. So it had nothing to do with blood quantum at the time. It had to do with affiliation. And so that's why a lot of folks will come and they don't have a lot of degree of Cherokee blood, but they still are Cherokee. I'm a perfect example. my daughter, my grandbabies are Eastern Band Cherokee, and so by Cherokee law, I'm full-blood Cherokee, and it has nothing to do with blood quantum at all. So that's old-school tradition. Mr. Ricker over here, he portrays someone that might be considered a long hunter.
Well, every man that brought his family across these mountains, one of the first things he done when he got ready to move was make sure that his rifle was in working order. Now, there were several gun builders over across the mountain, up in Virginia, North Carolina, but this is a flintlock rifle, okay? Got a little piece of flint, same stone that the Cherokees made arrowheads out of, and in the, it's called the cock here, the hammer. This rifle, I'm sure most of you older people, especially like me, has heard the term lock, stock, and barrel. Yeah. Well, that came from these rifles, because this is the lock, of course this is the stock, and this is the barrel. If you have the whole gun, you own it lock, stock, and barrel. That's where that term came from. But a man's life and the protection of his family and to feed his family depended on his rifle. And how?
Yes, since you were here, but you came here last week.
All right. Okay, here we go, guys. Fire in the hole. Fire in the hole!
That was good.
Didn't misfire at all, did it?
Davy, when he was a young man, you know, he met these people. He met John Sevier. He met Jacob Brown. These were the men that helped shape his future. So Davy Crockett's birthplace absolutely ties into John Sevier and all the Over Mountain men. So you just keep that, because a lot of people, they come here and they get this image of Davy Crockett, the frontiersman. Well, he was a little boy when he lived here, and it was a different time. It was the time of the Over Mountain men, and his dad was one of them. Any more questions?
Talk about Philadelphia. You introduced it to Philadelphia.
Yeah, we took this story, the Over Mountain Men to Philadelphia, the opening of the Revolutionary War Museum, last fall before I got a little under the weather. We went to Yorktown and done it before Cornwallis surrendered all the British troops. So I have took this story everywhere, and that's my job. That's what I'm going to continue doing. And to me, John Sevier and Isaac Shelby was two of the greatest Americans that ever lived. I don't know if any of you guys studied much about old Isaac Shelby, but he's one of my heroes too. He fought in the French and Indian War when he was 13 years old, took his first scalp. He fought in the Revolution, of course, in the King's Mountain. And he fought in the War of 1812. And then he became the first governor of Kentucky. So him and John Sevier is two of my all-time heroes, absolutely. Well, all the frontiersmen. I always told myself when I was a little boy, I'm gonna be a frontiersman when I get big.
Tyler Graveyard, Sherrill's, and the original house set out about where the cabin, behind the cabin, field stones. Does the cabin have anything historical?
Not that I'm aware of. And there's some stone remnants over here in the middle of the field. It looks like there may have been another stone structure there. But according to the current owner, his name is Jeremy Dykes, he says the original foundation and the original home is very close to that log little cabin out there.
Okay. I believe I'll walk out there real quick.
The picture. Yes, there
okay.
you go. The younger generation needs to.
So with your permission, we have people to weed whack.
For being willing, but those weed whackers must be big for them.
See, the more you pull, the more you see.
All right, guys, they're going to weed whack.
Say that if anybody will give me their email, I have what I'm about to say in a little photo essay I can send you. But I've been coming, Major James is one of my ancestors, and I've been coming with my parents since I was young. And 50 years ago, the James's house was right there. It was a two-story brick such as you've seen in Tennessee many times. There are a lot of them in Greenville, just a very simple house. We were told that that shed was built from the bricks from the house. And now I want to quickly talk about these. When we were here 50 years ago, and I have photographs that show this, which I will send you, Major James, that stone that's resting on the crypt does not go with the crypt. The two old stones were there, and her inscription was clearly visible, and I have a photograph of it. The neighboring right next to it would look just like that. Completely, it had completely sheared off the front. There was no inscription, but we were told that the matching stones were Major James and Nancy Conway. I think the crypts are all later, and 50 years ago there were at least 10 other smaller stones that one of which is resting right there. But many probably were children, but there are a lot more people here than have monuments. And anyway, so I'm just tickled to death to be here and hope to come back. And the last thing I would like to say is that Major James and Nancy Conway had the best view on the planet. Look around. This is just gorgeous. Oh, I told him.
And thank
that.
You again to James Hansen.
Absolutely.
To allow us and his family on his farm. Great. That's really nice.
All right, guys.
Okay.
Also, we should thank Ralph, who comes here twice a year. He's not a descendant, and he cleans this twice a year with no one asking him, with no photographers. He does it out of respect for our ancestors. So I think that's, we should applaud
him. Thank you, Ralph. If it wasn't for John Sevier, my ancestors wouldn't be alive. So.
Bless your cup of tea, can't you? Children. Herbs.
Left, wheel. Right,
ting,
and then
your mom gets
it and says,
"Hold." Left, right. Forward. March. Right. Turn. Kneel. Turn. Hold. Yeah. Face. Dress right. Dress. Poise. Arms. Present. Arms. Reverse. Arms. Mourn on arms. Steps and dismissed. Huzzah!
Huzzah! My wife would be sad she missed that.
Hours now, between now and 4 p.m., there's a live show going on just right out this back door. Revolutionary War show, so they're playing music, they're firing cannons right here in Watauga, so just go outside the door. And then we have a private tour set up at 4 p.m. for the museum. But essentially, it's free time. You don't have to go outside. You can stay here. And then also, our cousin Mary has brought her DAR books and her green books, if anyone wants to do genealogy. And this is an early Tennessee women DAR book. So she'll be in here doing that. So enjoy the next couple hours. And then also, we're having dinner here, not in this room, but outside. There are some shelters, and so they're all rented for us for the rest of the day. And that's where dinner will be.
Oh, yeah.
So firing by volley is when every man fires at the same time. If you're armed with a British Brown Best musket, it's a smooth bore, it's not accurate at all. So the more people you have firing at the same time, the more firepower you have to take out your enemy. Since it's not an accurate weapon, then you're going to use the musket in a lot better fashion than you can if it was just one firing individual. Major, by your leave.
Company, make ready! From the right, by fire!
No, volley.
By volley, fire!
Bye-bye! What the flip?
Go, fire lock! Secure your fire lock!
Suckers!
Have the men prime and load, individually down the line. And the premise behind that is by the time the last man has fired, the first man has reloaded and is ready to fire again, so that you can give a rolling fire down the line and hopefully keep your enemy at bay.
About it, put yourself in their shoes. They're going off to fight an enemy. They don't know how large. Technically, the most powerful military in the world. They're leaving their families. They're not getting paid by the Continental Army. They're risking everything. And this was their last sermon by a minister.
my countrymen, you are about to set forth on expedition which is full of hardships and dangers, but one on which the Almighty will attend you. The mother country has her hand upon you, these American colonies, and would take from us that for which our fathers planted their homes in this wilderness, our liberty. Your brethren across the mountains are crying out like Macedonia unto your help. God forbid that you should hear and not answer their call. Brave men, you are not unacquainted with battle. Your hands have already been taught to war, and your fingers to fight. You have wrested the beautiful valleys of the Holston and the Watauga from the hand of the savage. Will you tarry now, while the other enemy brings fire and sword to your very door?
No,
it shall not be. Go forth then, in the strength of your manhood, to the aid of your brethren, the defense of your liberties, and the protection of your homes. And may the God of justice go with you and give you victory. Let us pray. Almighty and gracious God, thou hast been the refuge of thy people throughout all ages. In time of sorest need, we have learned to come to thee, our rock and our fortress. Thou knowest the many snares and dangers that surround us on march and in battle. Thou knowest the many dangers that threaten the humble, well-beloved homes which thy servants leave behind them. Oh, in thy infinite mercy, save us from the cruel hand of the savage and the tyrant. Thou, who promised to protect the sparrow in its flight, keep ceaseless watch by day and by night over our loved ones. The helpless women, the little children, we commit to thy care, for we know that thou wilt not forsake them in times of loneliness, anxiety, and terror. O God of battle, arise in thy might. Confound those who plot for our destruction. Crown this mighty effort with victory and smite those who would exalt themselves above liberty and justice and truth. And help us as good soldiers to wield the sword of the Lord and of Gideon. Amen.
Yeah.